So everyone's here familiar with the term face your fears. Well, I have a confession to make. I grew up fearing the concept of making mistakes. Imperfection was just such a daunting feeling for me. Why do you ask? Confession number two. I grew up with what you call the classic tiger mom. This is actually a photo I took from my family album. There you see me, right there. Anyways, I digress. As I pursued a career in the culinary arts, it was working with food that helped me get over the fear of imperfection. Making mistakes in the kitchen played a significant role in my recipe development. I found myself more daring, willing to experiment with different flavors and texture combination. It was freeing to feel this lift of constraint of worrying about being perfect with no mistakes. Cooking is where I learn to stop yes-butting myself. Yes-butting is when you prevent yourself from executing and acting on these ideas. Why? Because you've written these ideas off even before writing down on a piece of paper, convincing yourself that these ideas inevitably will become mistakes, filtering them out before testing and experimenting. So take cup for cup. The original formula took me about a year and a half to finalize. A year and a half is a very long time to make a lot of mistakes. So coming out with a correct ratio of ingredients that would yield a blend that performed similar to wheat flour, it wasn't an easy task. There were many times where I felt defeated because during that year and a half, I just wasn't getting it. You're bound to fall, pick yourself up, try again and again. So that's what I did for a year and a half. Pick myself up and again. And what I discovered along the path was all of the knowledge I gained through those mistakes has actually left me with a whole nother set of new products. So, and also these, while the original formula took me about a year and a half, these products actually were produced all within months. And best of all, my mistakes I made resulted in providing people with food memories. All of these images actually are people with celiac who use cup for cup to make their family pie recipes. So my impression for you guys is to go out there, make mistakes, because you never know what those mistakes will lead you to. But on a sidebar, it's only mistakes in relations to food science experiments. Everything else I can't condone. So thank you.
I'm supposed to come and I guess talk to you about the process of creativity in how you figure things out or how you discover things. So what I do for a living, what I normally do, like what I'm known for, is if anyone knows, is using new techniques and technologies to kind of push forward the boundaries in both food cooking, what a lot of people call, I think unfortunately, molecular gastronomy. It's a horrible term. Please, none of you use it when you're speaking to me, unless you have a lot of time to have me yell at you for why it's such a crappy term, mainly because it sounds terrible, like it tastes nasty. But this is kind of what I'm known for. I also do it a lot in cocktails. But really, that's only the tip of the pie. How many of you guys have read On Food and Cooking, Harold McGee? Yeah, some of you? Go out and buy it if you don't have it. Really, I think what is important isn't that you use a piece of technology or that you use a new piece of equipment. Really, it's that you try to understand what it is that's going on when you're cooking. For me, it's cooking and making drinks. That's what I do for a living. I don't know what you guys do for a living or what you want to do for a living, but I think the same kind of concept applies. And the way to become creative in it isn't necessarily to use a new fancy piece of equipment. It's to become unhinged in a very analytical way, right? And so I think that's the whole premise of creativity. People ask, how do you think of this? How do you think of that? Why'd you come up with this? Why'd you come up with that? And it's because over years, I've built up a large memory in both my hands, my mind, and my palate of what different things taste like, how different things cook, and I remember almost all the tests I've ever run, right? And I observe and I record, because anytime you're gonna try to advance, you have to observe and record your mistakes, because most of my best ideas have come from things that I considered originally to be mistakes. But it's doing it in kind of an analytical way. So I'm gonna go over a couple of different examples of how that's the case. And the first one, because it takes a while, I'm gonna do is this experiment we're gonna do with a product called gymnemic acid. Okay, Okay, so one of the problems that a lot of people have when they're cooking, right, or when they're thinking about anything, is getting outside of their own head about what's good and what's bad. A lot of you have just had apples, right? Apple pie. Almost all of you think that an apple should be crunchy. Who here thinks an apple should be crunchy? Why? Why? I'll tell you why. It's because you're used to mealy, crappy apples out of a supermarket, right? Well, turns out you guys just have a prejudiced view of what an apple should be, okay? In fact, had you grown up in had you grown up in Victorian England, right, you would appreciate most the crumbly apple, right? The dessert apple, an apple that had a more similar texture but a real taste to what we call a Red Delicious, which is, of course, almost universally hated here, right? Most of you hate the Red Delicious because it is red but not delicious. All right. So the point being that you and your minds have thought that you really want a crunchy apple. You're not focused on what else an apple could be. I would bet that most of you, even if you were going to make apple juice, if you were tasting an apple and the apple wasn't crunchy, you'd say the apple was bad, right? And it's because you haven't taken the time in your head to analyze what it is that you want out of this particular apple in this situation. And a lot of times it's not crunch, right? So what we're going to do, what I'm going to do today is I'm going to run a little experiment to try and unhinge your mind, all right? And we're going to use a product called gymnemic acid, gymnemia silvestri. Who here has tried this product before? Ooh, only one. Nice. Okay, this is it's a plant. I believe it comes from the Indian subcontinent, although I never bother looking it up. And its name translates, whatever the name is in when it's used in Ayurvedic medicine, translates roughly to the sugar destroyer. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to take this veg cap. I want you to unhinge it. This green powder will not kill you. However, it tastes horrible. It tastes really bad. How many of you have kept rabbits? It tastes like their food and smells like their cage. It's terrible. You're gonna suck it up for science, is what you're gonna do. You're gonna put this in your, I'm gonna do it with you. You're gonna put this in your, dump the powder in your mouth. You're not gonna swallow it. You're gonna coat your tongue with it. You're gonna keep it in your mouth for long enough for the effects to, you'll be able to taste again within about 45 minutes. Don't worry, your dinner will be fine. Ready? Ready? Ready. Oh, I'll tell you when to swallow. Just do what I do.
Coat. Don't swallow. Just coat the whole tongue. Coat the whole tongue. Coat the whole inside your mouth. Coat. Coat. Okay, now you can start to swallow. Make sure your whole tongue is coated. Oh, all right. Now, before we taste anything else, let that die down. Don't drink water quite yet. Give yourself a minute. You just now tasted it after all that? All right. You're not going to die from this. Okay. Now, give it a second. Have you all recovered from the nastiness? A little bit? All right. This is a packet of sugar. Taste it. Tastes like sand. I have erased your sense of sweet. Aww. Now here's the problem. Like, for all you guys that think about sugar as just being something that's sweet, here's a marshmallow. You know how many people ask me how to make savory marshmallows? Why don't you just taste what the textural effect of sugar is without any of the flavor effects? It's crazy, huh? It's better with like a big one because you get a lot of textural effect. Try the chocolate. But notice the texture of the chocolate is still excellent. The texture of baker's chocolate sucks because the texture of baker's chocolate doesn't have the sugar in it to modify the texture of the chocolate. This has a nice texture, but it just tastes terrible because it lacks the sugar. Here's a real shocker. By the way, if you guys have some pie left, now would be an interesting time to taste what pie tastes like. If you still have some room with when there's no sugar in it, you will be astounded. Strawberries. We don't think of strawberries as being especially sweet unless you get good quality strawberries, which I guess you do here in California. But what you also don't realize is the super high acid level in a strawberry. Taste a strawberry without the sugar. It's a lot more acidic than you thought, right? Isn't that nuts? Now here's where it gets very interesting. The only thing that remains, by the way, how many of you have done like flavor tripping with miracle berries? Know what I'm talking about. That's where you eat this berry that makes sour things also taste sweet. If you really want to kill somebody's buzz on one of those expensive parties, gymnemic acid, because it actually wipes out your sweet sensors, trumps miracle berry. So if someone eats their expensive miracle berry and then you give them some gymnemic acid, you wipe them out. Little tip. But try the honey. Honey is the only thing that retains, by the way, it also wipes out saccharin, it wipes out sodas. If you guys have a Coke or a Pepsi or whatever, or any sort of cola, and you want to taste pure phosphoric acid and bitter cola flavors without the sugar, go pound that Coke now and then get back to me on it. Try the. I can't open my honey packet because, as I said, I'm incompetent. But, geez. But honey. Honey is a testament to how important your olfactory sense is to your taste. Because even though it doesn't taste sweet, notice how there is some sweetness to the honey. Do you guys get that? Who gets that? Yeah, but none of that sweetness is coming from your actual tongue. The sweetness is coming from your brain telling you that this flavor, this smell is sweet. So what I do when I do this sort of nonsense at home, which I don't do anymore because I've been doing it for years, so I only do it now for demonstrations, is I sit around and I eat boatloads of things that taste terrible and register in my head what the sugar is doing besides flavor, right? And so the reason this is instructive to you is because now you can think about what sugar is doing in a fruit. Like I used to use it for, anyone here make apple cider, like the hard stuff? Yeah, so one of the classic problems that people have when they're making apple cider is they have a very difficult time fermenting out the sugar in their brain and tasting what the acid level of the fruit is like once the sugar is fermented out. Guess what? Gymnemic acid will help you do this because you can wipe the sugar out of the apple prior to the fermentation and kind of get your acid balance levels beforehand. So I use this kind of thing just as an instructive tool in my head to try and figure out how sugars and acid, how sugars and texture are actually interacting, and I can use this to my advantage. And I encourage you to always think this way when you're cooking or when you're thinking about anything. That even if you don't have any idea, as some of you I know didn't when you're starting with your pie process, even if you have no idea why something happens, if you have a hypothesis and you control and you keep adapting, recording what your results are and working step by step, even if you start with the complete wrong reason for why you're doing, you can get to the right place.